knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
Now that we have covered both siliciclastic and biogenic sedimentary rocks, we are ready to move on to chemogenic rocks. These are rocks that chemically precipitate from natural waters, often involving evaporational concentration. Hence, they are often called evaporite minerals. Though there are other types of chemical sedimentary rocks, such as iron formations and phosphorite deposits, this tutorial will focus on evaporite rocks since they are much more common. Because evaporite rocks precipitate from natural waters, they are dominated by minerals that are salts. The carbonate, chloride, and sulfate salts are especially common. Evaporite rocks can form from the evaporation of either fresh water or seawater, with the water's chemistry being the main factor determining which evaporite minerals precipitate and in what order. Marine evaporites are dominated by the calcium sulfate minerals gypsum and anhydrite, as well as halite, with lesser amounts of calcite, potassium salts, and magnesium sulfate. Because seawater is essentially globally homogeneous, the minerals that are precipitated during its evaporation follow a specific sequence. Calcite forms first, followed by gypsum, then halite, concluding with various potassium and magnesium-rich salts. This sequence is dictated by the relative solubilities of the minerals, with the most insoluble salts precipitating first. If one were to entirely evaporate a beaker of seawater, almost 80% of the total precipitated salts would be halite. On the other hand, non-marine waters can be much more compositionally variable, reflecting local variations in bedrock mineralogy. Though in general, non-marine waters tend to be enriched in bicarbonate and depleted in chlorine with respect to seawater. The thickest and most laterally extensive evaporite deposits were formed from the evaporation of seawater and are often predominantly composed of halite and gypsum/anhydrite. Gypsum is the hydrated version of calcium sulfate and readily converts to anhydrite after burial. The conversion of gypsum to anhydrite involves a 38% decrease in volume as the lattice is dewatered, which often results in the deformation of gypsum deposits, especially since anhydrite is sometimes converted back to gypsum later during uplift and exhumation. As a result, calcium sulfate deposits are commonly heavily distorted, even in tectonically quiescent areas. Gypsum and anhydrite can form a nodular texture, sometimes called chicken wire anhydrite. It forms during the early stages of diagenesis, when gypsum crystals grow within deposits of carbonate mud, displacing and compacting the mud. Evaporite rocks are sometimes laminated, as in the Castile Formation of New Mexico. It consists of up to 300 feet of interbedded calcite and gypsum, with many of the individual layers spanning great distances. In other words, it has great lateral continuity. The cyclical variation between calcite and gypsum deposition probably represents some regular variation in climate, perhaps being driven by alternating wet and dry seasons. Recall that when seawater is evaporated, calcite precipitates first, followed by gypsum, then halite. Consider the state of the system right as calcite precipitation stops and gypsum precipitation begins. Why does calcite stop forming? Let's consider which variables we are changing. We are concentrating the solution via evaporation, so we are reducing the activity of water. This would not stop calcite from forming. We are also crystallizing calcite, and by doing so, removing calcium carbonate from solution. If we were to run out of either calcium or carbonate ions, calcite would not be able to form. Since gypsum is the next phase to precipitate, we know that calcium is abundant, so we must be running out of carbonate ions. If the chemistry of seawater was different, and instead we ran out of calcium before carbonate, the next mineral to precipitate in sequence might have been nacolite or sodium bicarbonate, since there would be no calcium left to make gypsum. So to summarize, the crystallization sequence of natural solutions is influenced by several chemical divides that arise during its compositional evolution, which is driven by the sequestration of chemical components via crystallization. This process is very similar to the differentiation of magmas discussed in previous tutorials. Let's now apply this to the Castile Formation to explain the cyclic repetition of calcite and gypsum. If we start with calcite, then gypsum would start to form once all the carbonate is exhausted. To start forming calcite again, carbonate would have to be added to the system, which can easily be accomplished by inflow into the basin via rivers and streams. Furthermore, most rivers tend to have much higher amounts of carbonate than sulfate. So each calcite gypsum bundle probably represents an influx of fresh carbonate-rich water into the basin, followed by evaporation, leading to the depletion of carbonate via calcite crystallization and the subsequent precipitation of gypsum. This is interpreted to represent cyclical variations in climate, with calcite being deposited during wet periods and gypsum during dry periods. Above the Castile Formation is the Salado Formation, which consists of interbedded halite and gypsum, indicating that the basin became more concentrated with time. Halite deposits are often called rock salt and can occur in deposits up to 2 kilometers thick in some areas. Most large halite deposits are thought to have formed from the evaporation of seawater in large restricted basins existing in arid environments. Since there are no modern analogs for the evaporation of seawater on such a large scale, geologists have proposed several models for the formation of such deposits. They all involve large coastal depressions that are separated from the ocean by a barrier of some sort, such as a barrier bar, which is just a subaerial ridge of beach sand. The barrier, or sill, impedes mixing between the basin water and ocean water, allowing the basin water to become highly concentrated via evaporation. In order to form kilometer-thick salt deposits, there must be a regular influx of solutes into the basin, providing the materials to make the salt. For example, even if the entire Atlantic Ocean were to be fully evaporated, the resultant salt deposit would only be around 50 meters thick. This can be accomplished in a few ways, such as seawater washing in during storm surges, or the seepage of seawater into the basin through the sill. Evaporite rocks are extremely susceptible to diagenesis because they are so soluble. Therefore, it is very common to find substantial dissolution and recrystallization, especially in older deposits. Salt deposits also have the unusual property of high mobility, causing them to behave more like viscous magma than solid rock, if they are buried deep enough. There are many places on Earth where salt is rising up through the crust, and even erupting from the surface in some cases, as in the many salt glaciers of Iran. The movement of salt after deposition, or salt tectonics, creates many interesting geologic structures, such as salt domes, which often make great structural traps for oil and gas. The oil deposits in the Gulf of Mexico are a great example of this. With chemogenic rocks covered, we have completed our assessment of the classification of sedimentary rocks and our analysis of sedimentary rocks in general. Let's move on to our third and final type of rock, metamorphic rock.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.